So what I'll do in the next 7 minutes is take you through 7 key insights that came through from the interaction that the GoFrugal and the RAI teams did over the last 1 month with a number of retailers. This is meant to be both a teaser and a curtain raiser. The full study will be available at 4:30 this evening. We're also planning to do a roundtable where a number of the retailers who took part in the study will offer deeper insights. So this, like I said, is meant to be both a teaser and a curtain raiser. It's always worthwhile to start with the obvious question. Why? Why are we doing this? So I think everybody knows the basic structure of the retail market. 6% of the $440 billion or 250,000 crore market is organized. There's a large segment of what we call mom and pop retailers. But I think what's not as well appreciated yet is in the last 10 years, there is a mid-segment of retail. Okay? These are what we call organizing retailers. They're typically relatively small, so we're talking 2 to 20 stores, turnover maybe under 20 crores, but they have started to modernize. So typically symptoms of that would be you would see things like billing and inventory being automated. So what we did was we reached out to about 23 of them. This is a qualitative interaction. It's aimed at gauging their pulse. What do they feel about the market? And what we wanted to do was to talk to you about 7 key messages coming out of that. We had retailers from a number of categories and segments. So you had apparel, you had grocery, you had food, you had restaurants. You also had fast fashion, cosmetics, and jewelry. So that's the framework on which we want to present all the results. It's qualitative. So on each dimension, whether it's business growth, down through technology, regulatory policy, think of it as a series of traffic lights. Okay, red is stop, danger, green is go. So if you think about, so just in terms of the first two, which is state of play, state of business growth and profitability. Couple of things I want to point out. The black marker shows the scale, and the arrow next to it shows the overall sentiment, if you like, okay, the direction. So while growth's been reasonably good, everybody spoke about numbers north of 15% year on year, same sales store growth and overall business growth for the last 3 or 4 years, margins have been shrinking. Okay, a few of them said stable margins, but nobody really said margins were expanding. This is probably the single biggest insight, creating a brand from scratch, from ground up. The biggest challenge for the entrepreneur or the family-owned business, as the case may be, in the first, say, 10, 15 years of setting up the business is this. Creating that mind space in the customer's mind. Now, there have been mechanisms that people are using to deal with this. So, for example, you have an Anjappar restaurant in Chennai which is using franchising as a way. So, they're working off the fact that Anjappar is a strong brand in the Chettinad food space. Some companies are creating own labels. So, you have a Leo Bags which sells their own merchandise along with a strong brand like, say, an American Tourister. A lot of retailers, especially in food, grocery, spoke about service as a mechanism for creating a brand. And a couple of them who are in men's occasion wear, so that's Gatsby, that's Lagan, they also offer bespoke tailoring as an extension of the service proposition. Okay. In a sense, what's happening there is that the business, sometimes the categories themselves have morphed. They've moved up the value chain. You've had textile companies who've forward integrated, quote unquote, from being manufacturers into retailers. You've had the reverse as well. You've had companies which have been selling textiles going backwards into manufacturing and branding the manufactured textile that they're selling. So just to give you a sense of some of the insights that we picked up in terms of the, if you like, the, not disconnect, but the whole problem on pricing power. There is, and some of this has been spoken about, right, in terms of what the e-com play is doing in the market. It's not just about predatory pricing, it's also what it's doing in the mind of the customer. for example, quotes that customers are expecting value, ambience, but the price dimension is completely different. Or the impact of inflation in that consumer durable, consumer discretionary spend on categories like apparel is actually going down. It's not like consumers aren't spending, and that was one of the key insights. Consumers are still spending, it's just that rupee for rupee they're not spending as much on categories like food. They seem to want to up the spend into things like personal electronic items. All the grocery retailers spoke about the impact of food inflation. It's well documented, but they did also say that they're not always able to pass on the impact to the customer. So this probably is the one quote which stands out in the entire exercise. This is from Ramana Silks in Madurai, and he speaks about the fact that he realized and recognized the power of e-com when he sees his store staff giving directions for the Flipkart delivery boy on High Street pretty much on a daily basis. I'll also come to what some of these retailers are doing as a response to this trend, but it's very clearly the fact that, from a competition perspective, they see both organized retailers on one end as well as e-tailers on the other end as being segments or, if you like, points of view that they have to deal with. Space and people, not surprisingly, space cost is going up, attrition is up. I think what was critical as an insight is the pace of increase of space cost and the fact that it's not limited just to the top 10 or 12 cities. The retailers who were spoken to, even in places like Salem, Tiruchi, Erode, Karur, Tanjore, talked about space cost, whether rental or owned, going up as much as 10 times in the last 10 years. When it came to people, so attrition is a fact of life. But a couple of interesting insights. One was that within retail itself, there is a dimension to attrition linked to brand. So it's not just about creating branding in the customer's mind, but also in the employee's mind. So for example, one of the respondents spoke about the fact that even banks give more loans to employees who work in stronger brands, if you like. Okay. The other insight, I think, was all retailers have, they seem to be, they've accepted the attrition as a fact of life, but the need really was, can we get cost-effective skilling solutions, especially in technical lines of retail, where product knowledge is important, whether it's apparel, whether it's paint retailing. They all said, is it possible to get skilling solutions by which we can cope with this? We understand this is now a fact of life. We want help in coping with it. Okay, this, at least for me, was one of the most surprising insights. Emerging retailers in this market are surprisingly social. And what I mean by that is that there are lots of brands who have created very credible social media communities, where they're looking at regularly engaging with customers, creating interesting content, running contests, even sometimes using the power of associated brands. So you have a Gatsby, for example, which has got almost 14,000 people on its Facebook page. Even a small organic store, okay, it's called Restore, they sell only organic food. Even they have a social media community 2,500 strong. There's a lady behind the helm of affairs. She sells online. She uses social media very extensively. But whichever way you look at it, to me, this was one of the most interesting findings coming out of it. I think the other thing, when it comes to e-commerce, there's no question that almost all the retailers looked at it and said, yes, must do, must list, must find a way to go online. Probably the only exceptions were the small format supermarkets or the really small grocery retailers, typically one or two stores, who felt that, you know, the touch and feel argument still applies to their business. The key thing though is most retailers were like, we're not very sure how to go about it. How do we list? Which marketplace? Why? How much is it going to cost? Is it going to make sense? So there is a little bit of a gap in the sense of being able to show quick, adoptable proof of concepts, if you like, on this particular area to the segment of retail. So the last one, and a lot has been spoken about this, right? The regulatory side. I think you can summarize it by saying accumulative, minor. So there are a number of what they call irritants, okay? But if I just step back and give you some of the big picture feedback, most of them are saying, if you must have rules, fine. Can we get clarity and speed? Okay, whether it's licensing to open a new store, whether it's how do we open our store for 365 days in a year. Okay, so things like this. Labor registers. For example, today's Economic Times talks about the government rationalizing some of the labor reforms. And guess what? Labor registers is one of the points mentioned over there. One of the other points of feedback we picked up was, can we know when the metro is going to invade our suburb and stay for the next 18 months so that we can plan investments around store layout, new store opening? So these were, like I said, they're minor maybe individually, but they're very accumulative. And something like FDI, reactions are fairly mixed. Some retailers felt it'll push up space cost, people cost. Other retailers were like, we're very relevant to our customer base. And if there are more retailers coming in, that's great, we'll learn from the best. On other topics, on GST, anybody who had, say, you know, 3 to 5 stores immediately looked at it and thought it'll be an enabler, especially when it comes to if you're purchasing outside the city or the state where you are. And lastly, there were about a third, so that's about 8 or 9 retailers who came out and said, can we get some kind of regulatory protection from, quote-unquote, the predatory pricing power of e-tailers? And that's already been commented about earlier in this conference. Okay, so there you have it. That's a summary, if you like. It's meant to be like a dashboard, something that you look at while you pilot your retail business to its destination. That's a summary of the state of play of independent retail. Like Kumar Wembu said, based on the feedback that we get from you, the feedback that we get from the roundtable that's planned later on today at 4:30, we would like to scale this up as a framework to keep getting insights from various retailers across multiple cities over the rest of the year or even going further forward after that. Thank you.